Father, we thank you so much for the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be here. Father, this morning we just came together to praise, honor, and glorify your name, and we just pray that that's what we do. And all the things that we say, sing, and do, that you're glorified. Father, we ask you this morning to inhabit the service with us, to enjoy the time with us as we share it together. We pray this in your Son's name.
Amen. Please stand.
My Father's house, there are many rooms. In my Father's house, there are many rooms, and I'm going up there now to prepare things for you, that there I am, and you may also be. Go prepare a place for you, I will come back again.
scripture reading comes from 1 Timothy chapter 6. It's entitled Instructions to Those Who Minister, which is not limited to only Tracy. All who are under the yoke as slaves are to regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and our doctrine will not be spoken against. Those who have believers as their masters must not be disrespectful to them because they are brethren, but must serve them all the more because those who partake of the benefit are believers and beloved. Teach and preach these principles. If anyone advocates a different doctrine and does not agree with sound words, those of our Lord Jesus Christ, and with the doctrine conforming to godliness, he is conceited and understands nothing, but he has a morbid interest in controversial questions and disputes about words, out of which arise envy, strife, abusive language, evil suspicions, and constant friction between men of depraved mind and deprived of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. But godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment, for we have brought nothing into the world, so we cannot take anything out of it either. If we have food and covering, with these we shall be content. But those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a snare and many foolish, harmful desires which plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is the root of all sorts of evil, and some by longing for it have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. But flee from these things, you man of God, and pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, perseverance, and gentleness. Fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called, and you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who testified the good confession before Pontius Pilate, that you keep the commandment without strain, without stain or reproach until the appearance of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who alone possesses immortality and dwells in unapproachable light, whom no man has seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. Instruct those who are rich in this present world not to be conceited or to fix their hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly supplies us with all things to enjoy. Instruct them to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is life indeed. O Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to you, avoiding worldly and empty chatter and the opposing arguments of what is falsely called knowledge, which some have professed and thus gone astray from the faith. Grace be with you.
You are my hope and my answer.
be nothing but the blood of Jesus. Nothing covers your sin. Nothing cleanses you like the blood of Jesus. It's fitting on this day of Valentine's that we celebrate that we think of the heart and we think of the blood. We think of Jesus, the one who came to sacrifice himself for us, who shed that blood for the covering of our sins and his body for us, so we might have the hope of salvation with him. This morning, as you prepare yourself to partake, think about the cleansing value of Jesus and his blood in your life, and where you'd be without it. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you so much for the love that you lavish on us every day. We thank you for your love of your Son that you sent for us to die a cruel death on a cross, to shed his blood, to break his body for us. Lord, this morning we come celebrating and remembering that sacrifice made. Father, we pray that you'll bless the cup, bless the loaf, bless those who partake. We pray this in your Son's name. Time for the offering. Once again, it's time for us to give back what God has richly blessed us with. And this week, just focus on Him. Focus on your life and look at how blessed you are. I mean, part of the scripture Jeff read about being clothed and being the roof of our head, the things that, I mean, look at us. We can look elsewhere in the world and see that people don't have that, don't have those things. And so we give so that the church can prosper, so that we can use it for the people here and the people elsewhere that need it. So this, today, think about what you can give based on your blessings. Let's pray. Father, once again, thank you for the day. Thank you for the opportunity to serve. Thank you for the opportunity to be here and to love and adore you. And Father, just now we want to give back to you what you have so richly blessed us with. Father, we pray that you'll take these tithes, these offerings, that you'll use them in your kingdom, for the betterment of your kingdom, both here and abroad. We pray this in your Son's name.
Hallelujah.
So we're going to be talking about love, and by love I mean. Thursday night we had a memorial for Sonia, Neil and Joel's daughter, and got here early and we're setting things up, and Liam comes running up to me and hugs my leg. And he says, "We're here to pray for my mother, because she's with Jesus in heaven." And if you could just see his face, I mean, just bright and cheery, he just loved the fact that mom's with Jesus. I don't know if he understands it all, you know, and understands what that means. I mean, in the days to come and stuff, he's going to realize, well, when he wants to see her or stuff, that it's going to come more real. But just the way he is, I mean, I always tell him, I said, you're my special buddy. You know, I got to their house, and then when I went to their house, talked to my name, ran up and just hung on, and he's like, "Come on." I think he wanted me to go to his room and play. Not what we were there for, but, you know, just that kind of love and that stuff. I mean, so innocent, so that's what God loves, isn't it? Stuff with the little children come unto me from stuff that's heaven. I mean, that innocence and stuff. So we're not that way. We're cynical. We've been around more years than him. We think of things. And when you think of the word love, what do you think? Now, I asked that question of some of my people on private chat, because I didn't want their answers all over out there, but I was surprised. When you say the word love, most people connect it to sex. And I was like, wow, that isn't what I was expecting, but that's what I got. And I was thinking, that's society. That's this world that, you know, the models have to be so thin and so this and the clothes and this. I mean, we make it look like that. I mean, look around the room and show me sexy.
Hey there.
I mean, we're the real world, aren't we? I mean, a little overweight, gray hair, no hair, you know. Short, tall, we're just the norm. We're not this thing that society wants you to tell you that this is what it is. It's not. And we have relationships. We're married. And in those marriages, there's struggles. There's good times, there's bad times, I mean, but we work it through. And then I asked the question in public to everybody, if God is love, can you love without God? And I got several answers. And so we want to look at that question today. Can you love without God? We're going to go to 1 John. 1 John. Chapter 4. We're going to be at verse 7. 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. It reads like this. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. So God is love, and if you don't know God, you don't know love. What do we have in this world? we have a lot of people that don't know God or don't profess God or don't live by godly standards. I mean, what do they have? Because they'll say to their spouses, I love you. But they don't know God, they don't know love. What is it they profess? And it is a form of love. It's love as they know it, as the world knows it. You know, love is a box of candy on today. Or if you go by the commercial, love's a diamond. Don't you get her a diamond? You don't love her. That's what society would say. You know, if you didn't do... But love's more than that, isn't it? And the love of God is so pure, it's greater than all of that. And so as we go through here, we're going to find some things out of what it says. It says, he that loveth not God knoweth not God. Or he who loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. That would tell you right here, you can't love without God. Not the love we're talking about. Not the level of love we're talking about. I mean, the level of love that you send your son to save a sinner. Think of it. Ken, could you send your son on behalf of some stranger who's a sinner?
I don't know.
To die the death on a cruel cross? Well, one, he can't because his son's blood wouldn't cover it, would he? Because his son's probably what? Sinner? Just like me, just like you? And it took pure blood. It took the pure blood of pure love from God to cover our sins. And so as we look at it, we say, okay, as a member of a loveless society, I cannot trust others. I cannot give the benefit of the doubt. That's what loveless society is. As a member of a loveless society, I cannot empathize with the suffering of others. Which means Thursday would have just been a sham, because we can't empathize with Joe and Neil on the loss of their daughter because we're loveless. In a loveless society, we can't spare the time or energy to reach out or to learn to love those who are different than us. Different in our thinking, different in politics, different in culture, different in race, or different in ethnicity. A loveless society does not love. That's what we find from Scripture. God is love, and if they don't have God, if they're loveless, if they're godless, how can they even say that they love? They have a form. Again, we say they have a form of it. What I got from the private question to the people that came back to me was, they had lust. They understand lust, the want of things. But in love, it's not the want, it's the giving. In love, it's not the want, it's the giving. It's the giving of self to someone else or to a group. I stand here this morning as your minister, and I love you. Because I love you, I'm going to try and give you the truth. I'm going to try and give you what's right so that you can build your life so that life can be better because of that love. I'm not going to give you lies based on things just to get something I want. It's not about me. This morning, if we're talking about real love, we're talking about God. The God of love. If we continue reading in 1 John chapter 4. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. So this is love. Not that we love him, but that he loved us. I'm going to tell you something. I am not easy to love. I'm just not. I'm I'm a sinner. I'm a person that, sure, you might help me, you might do things, but how are you going to die for me? How are you going to shed your body and blood for me? Now, there's relationships we have. There's a husband-wife relationship. There's a God relationship that we would say, yes, we'll do that. But, you know, love Doug. He's a member of the church. He's a brother in Christ. But him or me, you know, think about it. If you're honest, don't you? If it comes down to it, God didn't think about it. God said, I love you this much. Here. Take my son. Take my son. What was his hopes? That we would love him, that we'd follow him, that we would adhere to the things he's teaching. When God sent a son, I think God knew that his son would die. He sent his son as a sacrifice, it says. He sent him for us for the atonement of our sins. Not for the atonement of his sins, because he hasn't. But he sent his son out of love for us. For God so loved Margaret that God sent Jesus. That's how personal it is. God so loved Neil. God so loved Becky. God so loved Jeff. I mean, put your name there. For God so loved you that he sent his son. And in return, what have you done? See, I learned that I had to accept the gift. God said, here's my son, here's a gift. He's going to be your sacrifice. He's going to be your one last high priest. He's going to be the one that sits there. He's going to be it. And all you have to do is accept the gift. How many of you accepted it? Look at it. How many of you accepted it 100%? And I think we did. I truly think that when I walked that aisle and accepted him as my Lord and Savior, and as I was baptized into him, man, I was his. What happened? We were talking in Sunday school, starting the book of Nehemiah. I just started the book of Nehemiah, if you want to join us in Sunday school. A little commercial here. Nehemiah's new book. Amen. Join us and read what we're reading. And sit
Amen.
What did I say?
Amen.
We're not starting. That's what I have. What he was a pull from. We're in Nahum.
Yes.
Forget the other one. We're in Nahum, but you can join us in there. But in their book, it starts off where it says, God was a jealous and vengeful God. Jealous of what? Jealous of Tracy walking an aisle, accepting his son, saying, I'm all yours, and taking some back. Jealous. And he says, he will not let any go unpunished for their sin. Won't let any. Not you, not me. I mean, it's going to happen. But he's a jealous and vengeful God because he wanted all, and we came forward and we fully, wholeheartedly believed that we were going to give him all. And then what? And that what is up to you. What was it that took 1% of that 100% away? That took 2%? That took 10%? So I stand here before you, and I'm telling you, I try my best, but and I'm not. Some days I'm 100%, some days I'm just not. It's a work. It's a relationship. Dawn of my relationship, it's work. It's a relationship. It takes work and functioning, the ins and outs, to do those things, and me and God are the same way. And I find myself going to him a lot saying, I love you. But I blew it today. I love you, but I didn't do it right. I love you, but... And then I find myself asking me, do I really love him? Because if I really loved him, I would do it. I would be right. I would. So you go to that big circle, but God is love. And if God is living in you, you have love. If God is in you, and if you accepted that gift, and he's your Lord and Savior, you have the ability of forgiveness. You have the ability to get back to that perfect love relationship with him. Not what society would think it is, not what you think it is. 1 John 4, verse 20, skipping ahead, says, if a man says, I love God and hateth his brother, he's a liar. And this commandment have we from him, that we loveth God and love his brother. He who loveth God loves his brother. I mean, do you love God? Do you harbor hate in your heart towards any of his creation people? Now, it's tough. I'm putting this together, and I'm slapping myself. I mean, I'm not real thrilled with our new president and some of the executive orders she's given. But I have to love my brother. I'm not thrilled with some things they're doing in Hollywood, but I gotta love my brother. I can go throughout society and this world and say, man, there's some things that I just, but that person in charge, I gotta love them. Doesn't mean I have to associate with them. It doesn't mean I have to accept what they're doing or like them, but I have to love them because they're part of God's creation. And who here is not redeemable? So as I'm putting this together, I think, gosh, you know, I can't love God and love his creation and harbor hate in my heart, can I? But here I am, your minister, standing in front of you saying, gosh, I struggle with some of these things because there's some of these people that just drive me bonkers. I mean, there's things that just get to you. I mean, I walked away from a porch the other day. We come up and a lady came out and she's like, oh, do you have to do what you're going to do? Yes. It's called in, it's here. There he is right there. Oh, and she goes out on her porch and screams and hollers and scares the gator. We're out of it. I mean, we've been there several times. We know that this gator's not coming back up. And Drew patiently is standing at the bank, hoping, come on, pop your head. I walked down the bank all the way to the other side of the lake and told the bait that we had there, went back to the truck. And I had to do that. I knew I had to do that. You know why I had to do that? Because I wanted to say to the lady up on the balcony, things I probably shouldn't say. Yeah. And it would have been like, well, who are you and what are you? I mean, is your dog the one? No, you're on the second floor. You don't have to worry about your dog, but these people have to worry about their dog out here because, and I would have just told her. But it was best just to walk away and just let it be. And she's like, are you not going to get it today? No, ma'am. Nope, we're just going to go. Because it was better for all. You've seen those situations.
But Drew was aiming the pull at her.
Yeah, we did have the hook aimed at her, not the lake. No, but it's you know, you get in those situations. That's just a little example of just something that you walk away. You don't exasperate the situation. You know, how many times in your life has something come up and you're just like, ooh, walk away. Cool down so that you can share the truth and the love that you should be sharing, stuff like that. Not something else. I mean, and there's so many examples I can give you throughout life that you gotta learn just to walk away. And it's a really sad thing. Well, I won't share it because they might get upset. There's situations in the church sometimes that as a minister, I just have to step aside for a minute because you really don't want me to tell you what you're asking. People want to hear what they want to hear. They're don't necessarily always want to hear the truth. And in God and the love of God, if you love God and you have God, truth is what prevails. And so you do those things. If a man says, I love God and hateth his brother, he's a liar. So I can't hate. I've got to love him. John Eric said, I don't have to like him. That's true, I don't like him, but I've got to love him. Because they too are a creation of God, and I've got to try my best to win them. I mean, I shared a story in Sunday school about this week with the funeral people in the family. I mean, to win them. Try your best to get them swung over, to look at, to think about God. And a time of death is a hard time to get people to try to look at God, because maybe they're angry with them. Here are some of them, like, God, why? I prayed for you to do this and you didn't do it. It's okay. He knows best. He knows what was out in front of them. He knows what was coming, and sometimes it's best to do what he does and just take it from them. And we don't see that at the point. We don't see that, and we're just angry and stuff. So it's harder in that situation to sit down with someone and say, you know Jesus? And to get them to look. But we have to try. Because the only hope they have through death is Jesus. And we've got to give them that hope that they can have that in their minds and their hearts. The world doesn't want us to have any of that. The world wants us to be theirs. Well, the world is Satan's labor. Satan wants us. Satan knows those things to do to trigger us and to change us and get us to look the other direction and try to do those things that we shouldn't be doing. And when we do, he throws another one at us, because if he can keep us down long enough, he can keep us away. If he can keep us away, he can weaken us. And if he can weaken us, he can maybe win us. The same exact thing I was talking about with the family there. I mean, trying to win them, come up to Christ and show them Christ, and at the same time Satan's going, no, you don't want any part of that. You don't want. Who are they going to listen to? Society tells you one thing, the Bible tells you another. Who are you going to listen to? And what's sad is sometimes we listen to society over the Bible. We don't have the love of God on us if we're doing that. We can't love Satan and love God. We can't serve two masters. So we have to choose. We can't love our brother and speak evil of him at the same time. We can't love our brother and ignore him. We can't love our brother and never tell him about Jesus Christ. We can't love our brother and curse him. We can't love our brother and not welcome him in. We can't love our brother and fear him. There in the same chapter in 1 John 4, verse 18, there is no fear in love, but perfect love cast us out the fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. You're not made perfect in love. Get that. I mean, we can't fear. We have to have no fear. We have to go forward with Christ. We have to go out and do it. I tell you all the time, I accepted Jesus as my Lord and Savior, and that first week in high school was tough. And that first week in high school, I blew it. When people said, hey, we hear something you come back, oh yeah, it was really nothing. Play it down. Oh yeah, well, you did. You know. Yeah, we were in church choir, we were in church basketball and church volleyball and softball and all the different things, but play it down, because they may not be accepting it. When in return what we should have been doing was playing it up so that they too could come to the knowledge that we had in the saving grace. But there we were. We can't do both. We can't fear what man might think or what God wants and his desire. As you read through there, starting with verse 16, and so we know and rely on the love of God, the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us, so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us. We love God because he loved us. And we have proof of his love. Proof. We celebrate it every week at the Lord's table. The proof of his love. That he'd send his son for us. What is the proof of our love to him? Scripture would have it say our sacrifice to him. But ours is different. He asked Jesus to come here and to die for us. Our sacrifice to him is to sacrifice the life we live here, to live a life in him. If we love God, we will live a life in him. We'll allow him. Paul says that I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. We shine that love of Christ and God through us for others to see that we can make a difference in this world because of them. And sometimes it's walking away. And sometimes it's going to be tough. And sometimes it's going to be hard. And sometimes you're not going to feel like doing it when he gives you an opportunity to do it. But in love, we do it. In love, we have to do it. We're it. We're the church. We're his hands and feet here on this earth. If we don't do it, who do we expect to do it? I mean, COVID has staggered churches in America. Staggered. The average church giving, down 40%. The average church attendance, down 58%. When asked ministers all across the country, do you think they're coming back? They resoundingly said, no. No. This is the church of today, becoming the church of tomorrow. And if we don't do it, who will? If we don't love, who will? If we don't share, who will? If we don't build the kingdom, who will? It's fallen upon us to love God, to love Jesus, to share him. So this year, as we celebrate Valentine's, as we look at that, it's not just love of our wife or husband, it's not just love of our kids. It's asking, do you have the real love in your life? Do you know God? Does God live in you and through you every day? Does he guide your path and your walk? Does he guide your direction and your talk? Is he the one that you pursue on a daily basis? He is. Every week we give an invitation, every week we give an opportunity for you to choose. This week's no different. I mean, we're not asking you to choose something simple. We're asking you to choose something eternal. We're asking you to love God with all your mind, soul, and spirit. To serve him with everything you have. If you're here this morning, you never give your life to Christ, it's an opportunity for you the first time to do that. To give your life to start to love him the way he loves you. Moreover, maybe it's we've given our life to him, and it's time for us to really start loving him the way he loves us. Completely, totally. To give him all. To walk with him every day of our lives. Serving him and making a difference in his kingdom for the sake of his Lord. Whatever your choice is, as we stand and sing,
purify my heart.
Are you ready to be set apart, to be refined, to be His, to go and to serve? I mean, that's our goal today, is to go and be with Him, serve Him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for the day. We thank you so much for the opportunity we have to be here. We thank you for the day of love that we share. Father, help us to love every day. To love you, to love your creation, to love those around us that we share you. That they come to a saving knowledge as we have with you, that Father, they too have the hope of eternity in heaven with you. Father, just guide us as we leave, guide us as we work this week, as we do the things before us. Help us to serve you in ways that we can. We pray this in your Son's name.